November 15th, Daily Video Bible Reading from the NET Bible, Ezekiel chapters 43 and 44 from the Old Testament. Then he brought me to the gate that faced toward the east. I saw the glory of the God of Israel coming from the east. The sound was like that of rushing water, and the earth radiated his glory. It was like the vision I saw when he came to destroy the city, and the vision I saw by the Kebar River. I threw myself face down. The glory of the Lord came into the temple by way of the gate that faces east. Then a wind lifted me up and brought me to the inner court. I watched the glory of the Lord filling the temple. I heard someone speaking to me from the temple while the man was standing beside me. He said to me, "Son of man, this is the place of my throne and the place for the soles of my feet, where I will live among the people of Israel forever. The house of Israel will no longer profane my holy name. Neither they nor their kings, by their spiritual prostitution or by the pillars of their kings, set up when they die. When they place their threshold by my threshold and their doorpost by my doorpost, with only the wall between me and them, they profane my holy name by the abominable deeds they committed. So I consume them in my anger. Now they must put away their spiritual prostitution and the pillars of their kings far from me, and then I will live among them forever. As for you, son of man, describe the temple to the house of Israel, so that they will be ashamed of their sins and measure the pattern. When they are ashamed of all they have done, make known to them the design of the temple, its pattern, its exits and entrances, and its whole design. All its statutes, its entire design, and all its laws. Write it all down in their sight, so that they may observe its entire design and all its statutes and do them. This is the law of the temple. The entire area on top of the mountain all around will be most holy. Indeed, this is the law of the temple. And these are the measurements of the altar. Its base is 1 3/4 feet high and 1 3/4 feet wide, and its border 9 inches on its edge. This is to be the height of the altar. From the base of the ground to the lower edge is 3.5 feet, and the width 1 3/4 feet, and from the smaller ledge to the larger edge 7 feet, and the width 1 3/4 feet, and the altar hearth 7 feet, and from the altar hearth 4 horns projecting upward. Now the altar hearth is a perfect square, 21 feet long and 21 feet wide. The ledge is 24.5 feet long and 24.5 feet wide on 4 sides. The border around it is 10.5 inches and its surrounding base 1 3/4 feet. Its steps face east. Then he said to me, "Son of man, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. These are the statutes of the altar. On the day it is built, to offer up burnt offerings on it and to sprinkle blood on it, you will give a young bull for a sin offering to the Levitical priests who are descended from Zadok, who approach me to minister to me, declares the Sovereign Lord. You will take some of its blood and place it on the 4 horns of the altar, on the 4 corners of the ledge, and on the border all around. You will cleanse it and make atonement for it. You will also take the bull for the sin offering, and it will be burned in the appointed place in the temple, outside the sanctuary. On the 2nd day, you will offer a male goat without blemish for a sin offering. They will purify the altar just as they purified it with the bull. When you have finished purifying it, you will offer an unblemished young bull and an unblemished ram from the flock. You will present them before the Lord. And the priests will scatter salt on them and offer them up as a burnt offering to the Lord. For 7 days you will provide every day a goat for a sin offering. A young bull and a ram from the flock, both without blemish, will be provided. For 7 days they will make atonement for the altar and cleanse it, so they will consecrate it. When the prescribed period is over on the 8th day, and thereafter the priest will offer up on the altar your burnt offerings and your peace offerings, I will accept you, declares the Sovereign Lord." Then he brought me back by way of the outer gate of the sanctuary, which faces east, but it was shut. The Lord said to me, "This gate will be shut. It will not be opened, and no one will enter by it. For the Lord, the God of Israel, has entered by it. Therefore, it will remain shut. Only the prince may sit in it to eat a sacrificial meal before the Lord. He will enter by way of the porch of the gate and will go out by the same way. Then he brought me by way of the north gate to the front of the temple. As I watched, I noticed the glory of the Lord filling the Lord's temple, and I threw myself face down. The Lord said to me, Son of man, pay attention. Watch closely and listen carefully to everything I tell you concerning all the statutes of the Lord's house and all its laws. Pay attention to the entrances to the temple with all the exits of the sanctuary. Say to the rebellious, to the house of Israel, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. Enough of your abominable practices, O house of Israel. When you bring foreigners, those uncircumcised in heart and in flesh, into my sanctuary, you desecrated even my house when you offer my food, the fat, and the blood. You have broken my covenant by all your abominable practices. You have not kept charge of my holy things, but you have assigned foreigners to keep charge of my sanctuary for you. This is what the Sovereign Lord says. No foreigner who is uncircumcised in heart and flesh among all the foreigners who are among the people of Israel will enter into my sanctuary. But the Levites who went far from me, straying off from me after their idols, when Israel went astray, will be responsible for their sin. Yet they will be ministers in my sanctuary, having oversight at the gates of the temple and serving the temple. They will slaughter the burnt offerings and the sacrifices for the people, and they will stand before them to minister to them. Because they used to minister to them before their idols and became a sinful obstacle to the house of Israel, consequently I have made a vow concerning them, declares the Sovereign Lord, that they will be responsible for their sin. They will not come near me to serve me as priests, nor will they come near any of my holy things, the things which are most sacred. They will bear the shame of the abominable deeds they have committed. Yet I will appoint them to keep charge of the temple, all of its service, and all that will be done in it. But the Levitical priests, the descendants of Zadok, who kept the charge of my sanctuary when the people of Israel went astray from me, will approach me to minister to me. They will stand before me to offer me the fat and the blood, declares the Sovereign Lord. They will enter my sanctuary and approach my table to minister to me. They will keep my charge. When they enter the gates of the inner court, they must wear linen garments. They must not have any wool on them when they minister in the inner gates of the court and in the temples. Linen turbans will be on their heads, and linen undergarments will be around their waist. They must not bind themselves with anything that causes sweat. When they go out to the outer court, to the people, they must remove the garments they were ministering in and place them in the holy chambers. They must put on other garments so that they will not transmit holiness to the people with their garments. They must not shave their heads nor let their hair grow long. They must only trim their heads. No priest may drink wine when he enters the inner court. They must not marry a widow or a divorcee, but they may marry a virgin from the house of Israel or a widow who is a priest widow. Moreover, they will teach my people the difference between the holy and the common, and show them how to distinguish between the ceremonially unclean and the clean. In a controversy, they will act as judges. They will judge according to my ordinances. They will keep my laws and my statutes regarding all my appointed festivals and will observe my Sabbaths. They must not come near a dead person or they will be defiled. However, for father, mother, son, daughter, brother, or sister, they may defile themselves. After a priest has become ceremonially clean, they must count off a period of 7 days for him. On the day he enters the sanctuary into the inner court to serve in the sanctuary, he must offer his sin offering, declares the Sovereign Lord. This will be their inheritance. I am their inheritance, and you must give them no property in Israel. I am their property. They may eat the grain offering, the sin offering, and the guilt offering, and every devoted thing in Israel will be theirs. The first of all the first fruits and all contributions of any kind will be for the priest. You will also give to the priests the first portion of your dough, so that a blessing may rest on your house. The priest will not eat any bird or animal that has died a natural death or was torn to pieces by a wild animal. God, just like in Ezekiel's visions that you gave him, and just like in Isaiah's vision as well, where you filled the temple, I actually get goosebumps when I read about people seeing that in your temples, and it makes me think of all the people in the world that still aren't your people, that still aren't saved, that still aren't walking in a relationship with you, that still don't know your incredible, endless love and forgiveness and grace and mercy. God, I pray for them today. I pray for their hearts and their lives, that in your timing and according to your will, that they will become your people, that you will fill their temple, just like this vision of Ezekiel that we see, that your glory would fill their hearts, their minds, their lives, and through them, other people would see the glory of you as well. Just like sharing the story of Ezekiel, other people are hearing about your glory filling that particular temple. God, I pray for their lives with you, that as they start asking questions about you, that you'll continue to put obedient people in their lives to allow them to answer those questions and to help them with that walk. One of the things that you've commanded us to do is to be disciples who make disciples. And that walk as a Christian is narrow. And I would say that the walk with another disciple discipling you is even narrower. There's so many people that are caught up in this world and are too busy to help teach other, either new Christians or even more mature Christians. It's kind of interesting because we had this great sermon on Sunday where the pastor said, we were talking about disciples making disciples, and he said, okay, for all of you who have cell phones, you take them out right now, and I want you to text somebody who is above you and ask them to teach you the way. Ask them to disciple you. And then I want you to text somebody who doesn't perhaps know as much or is a newer Christian, and ask them if it's okay if you show them the way. And I thought that was just such an amazing exercise. And the response in our church was just amazing. All these new coffee dates of people going out and learning about God together and walking that path together. Accountability partners to me are different than discipleship partners, but sometimes the two cross over. And I just pray for all those exciting new relationships. But I was also a little bit sad on Sunday because I've asked five or six people in my church to disciple me. And they all told me in various terms that they were too busy. And God, that makes me sad that there's people out there, not just me, but there's people out there who want to learn, who are asking questions, who are passionate about finding out more about you. And maybe they're not even believers yet in these questions. And are we answering them that we're too busy? Sorry, I have to get my kids to the soccer match. Sorry, I have work to do. Sorry, my family's going on vacation. Sorry, whatever. Are we getting so caught up in the world that we forget what you've asked us to do? So God, I pray for these new people coming into faith with you. They may not be there yet, but they may be asking questions. And I pray for obedient Christians to answer those questions. Perhaps they're new themselves or they're mature Christians, whatever the situation is, that they will help guide your people in the way that you're asking them to. And then as their life progresses, allow them to see the other parts of this verse that Ezekiel's talking about, this vision that Ezekiel's talking about, where you take him, it says, back by way of the outer gate of the sanctuary, which faces east. And it was shut. That particular gate was shut. And you told Ezekiel, this gate will be shut. It will not be opened, and no one will enter by it. For the Lord, the God of Israel, has entered by it. Therefore, it will remain shut. And we know with the birth of your Son Jesus Christ and his eventual death on the cross for us, that the temple now resides in us. And we know once you come to live inside of us, that that is sealed forever. That by your crazy awesome grace and mercy and love for us, there's nothing we can do to remove that. So as they walk in that path with you, God, reassure them. Yes, you'll mess up. I mess up all the time. But that you're never leaving us. You're never forsaking us. You're never giving up on us. That you're there forever and ever for us, with us, and by us. God, I'm very excited for people coming to faith with you. And whatever that looks in my life, to be obedient to helping them, show me that path. Empower me to have the skills that I need when it comes that time. And then give me the strength to do what pleases you. I pray this all in your Son's Jesus Christ's name. Amen.